Thomas C. Campbell. He was a private in the United States Army who fought in World War II and spent up to 3 years in a Japanese prison camp. He had broad shoulders and a crew cut, being a quite handsome man. He is described as a complicated cat who loved kids and didn't put up with any foolishness from adults. He had a brown-eyed stare that would stop people cold. He loved to dance, and among his favorite songs were Stardust by Johnny Mathis and Mack the Knife by Bobby Darin. He also loved to fish in the Noxubee River, and for a man who so loved his country, Campbell enlisted in the Army February 15, 1941. He was trained in artillery and sent to the beautiful islands of the Philippines, which is paradise for a 21-year-old who's always been around the Mississippi. However, living in paradise would only last a couple of months. On December 7, 1941, the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor. And only hours after the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, they attacked Clark Field, which was the base Tom was stationed at, located on the mountainous island of Luzon. Campbell was in the 60th Coast Artillery, Battery E, which mostly consists of searchlights and some artillery. Campbell was in artillery. He would shoot down the airplanes that were bombing the islands. On one occasion of the air raids, Campbell saved the lives of many wounded by getting them back to camp. The wounds were so terrible that you would never know who would live or die. One time there was one soldier in the corner of a building and he had 2 fingers blown off. So Tom put him on his back and carried him out. The guy was in so much shock that he ended up dying. Tom also came across another soldier who had his stomach ripped open by a piece of shrapnel. The guy was literally pushing his intestines back inside his body, but ended up living. For that, Campbell earned the Silver Star that day, which is the third highest military decoration awarded for valor. Tom wielded the BAR rifle in his outfit. One time, Tom went up to the mountain a ways to go use the restroom. While he's up there, he heard machine guns going off. So he crawled down and looked over the edge of a cliff, and he could see the Japanese machine guns. They had a nest set up, and they had his platoon pinned down. So he started firing his BAR, killing every Japanese soldier there. For that, Campbell earned the first of his 4 Bronze Stars, which is the 4th highest military decoration awarded. However, islands were falling into the Japanese's hands. Luzon fell along with Bataan. Men were retreating to Corregidor, also known as the Rock. It was like the Alamo of the Philippines. Night bombings were common, and living conditions started to take its toll. Tom and his comrades ate all the birds and rats they could trap, even mules, dogs, and cats. People began starving to death. However, this was just the beginning of this torturous journey. As time was the enemy's friend, General MacArthur promised his troops, "I shall return." He left in command General Jonathan Wainwright, as Tom and the rest of his soldiers watched General MacArthur sail off into the bay. Therefore, May 5th through 6th, the Japs began invading Corregidor, which then led to the surrender of 11,000 POWs, announced by leading officer General Wainwright. The 80-mile, 6-day Bataan death march, the brutal transfer of approximately 70,000 U.S. POWs from Bataan to Pampanga had already occurred back in April. As many as 10,000 didn't survive. Tom's group was forced to do the exact same march, 80-mile march, and included the same torture, murder, and starvation as the previous march. Tom left the Philippines aboard the horrendous Tatori Maru on October 8, 1942. History would later call these ships hell ships. The men were packed in so tightly like sardines in the holds, with little room along with little food or water. They were in darkness for days at a time. Buckets for human waste were passed around from the hold as waste spilled on the people below. Animals had been carried in the holds before the men were even there, and they were not even cleaned. On October 9th, unknown of the Americans on board, an American submarine shot 2 torpedoes at the ship. The torpedoes simultaneously passed on either side of the ship, not hitting it. The ship arrived in Busan, Korea on November 9, 1942, where 1,300 American POWs were unloaded and sent to the first Mukden POW camp, while later moving to Houghton camp in 1943. Tom arrived in China by train to encounter freezing weather while wearing the ragged remains of his tropical clothing. Campbell endured a harsh first winter with temperatures falling 20 to 30 degrees below and occasionally to 50 below. During the first winter, they lost over 200 men. The ground was so frozen they couldn't even bury the soldiers until spring of next year. The Japanese Imperial Army didn't abide by the Geneva Convention of Treatment of POWs. The Japs found out Tom was from the South, a farm boy, and that he probably knew how to grow vegetables. So Tom and two other POWs were placed in charge of the garden that would help feed the camp. There was even a Japanese guard that would let Tom smuggle tomatoes and potatoes so that he would have more to eat than a ration of rice. Rather than work, torture became a common thing in Campbell's life as a POW. The beatings were so severe that fellow men lost consciousness, teeth, hearing, and had other symptoms of brain damage. Some bones were broken, but the object was more to humiliate and cause pain. No matter which way Tom looked, death was all around him. After 3 years, Campbell began losing his will to live. He spent up to 16 months with beriberi in his feet and legs. However, with the atomic bombs hitting Hiroshima and Nagasaki, the Japanese surrendered on August 15, 1945. On August 20th, 1945, Russian paratroopers came and officially liberated the camp, rescuing Campbell along with other POWs. Campbell, happy to be out, wrote his mother, Betty Lee Campbell, as the ship headed for San Francisco. On his way home to Sugarloaf, residents populated Betty Lee's house when they learned that the youngest of her three children had returned. Even one of Campbell's first visitors was his older brother, Jack, a state Golden Gloves boxing champion who had returned from his own duty in World War II as a turret ball gunner and the Army Air Corps B-17 bomber. 2 years later, Tom chose to further his military career and re-enlisted with the Air Force. He spent time in Biloxi, San Antonio, and Selma, and was eventually assigned to Elmendorf Air Base, just outside of Anchorage, Alaska. In his time with the Air Force, Campbell grew to the rank of an E-9 Chief Master Sergeant. In 1962, Campbell returned back to civilian life in Sugarloaf. He raised his two sons and served as a Marshal and Fire Chief of Sugarloaf from 1965 on. After all he had faced and conquered, Tom Campbell was still fighting a battle. He was told that he would not live long because of the trauma he went through as a POW. Tom turned to alcohol and became a full-blown alcoholic. Christmas came and he celebrated with a sizable extended family without the help of his alcohol. 3 days later, he felt he was a burden to his family, and so he walked into the bedroom wanting to end it. The shot from his .38 fired with 21 more shots fired at the funeral 2 days later. He was a man who served his country during one of the most important times in American history so that we could be free today. With his service to the military and his family, he has touched many lives. The horrors he experienced throughout his time makes you wonder how someone could possibly make it out of there alive. I think his son, Jimmy, sums it up when he said he wanted to get back to the Noxubee River and fish for them big catfish.